Well, welcome everybody. I am really excited that Mary Stakelum is here with us today. It's my job to introduce Mary. What I'm not going to do is list off a load of stuff that Mary's done, because if you Google Mary Stakelum music, you will find all of that stuff. But what you won't find is just a list of achievements. What you'll find is a picture of somebody who's not just a researcher, but a research leader, a research curator, somebody who is very generous with the way that she works with fellow colleagues. I've known Mary for quite some time, and she really is a person who takes an absolute active interest in everybody's research, wherever it is and whatever stage it is. She edits one of the key journals in music education. She directs one of the key international conferences in music education. And she does this all with her lovely, beautiful, calm, modest personality. She's really, really phenomenal. Phenomenal. Mary's scholarship is exquisite. And what I've always really loved about Mary is the depth of her thinking and the richness of her expertise that she brings into her research. And of course, education research, normally you have a career as an educator before you become a researcher. But I'm sure Mary will agree with me that actually teaching is research. And if you're not sure what I mean by that, read Freire's Pedagogy of Freedom, chapter 2, articulates it beautifully. But what Mary brings into her research, she's built up through her professional practice. Every single person that she works with informs herself, and she really understands the idea of the teacher being a scholar and learning through her students as well as her research. I've embarrassed her enough. So I'm really looking forward to this presentation, and I'm absolutely delighted to welcome Mary Stakelum to the Royal Northern College of Music.
And it is really a delight to be here, and I've had a lovely morning, or this lovely earlier time talking to the doctoral students, and it's lovely to see you here, so I feel already at home. I'm very keen to get started, because there's a lot on my mind, and I had great fun with the title, so I wanted to just to start with that, the title of To Infinity and Beyond, and I think Jenny encapsulated it very nicely, I think, in terms of the challenge for music educators and for music education research in the 21st century, to really actually, you know, take ownership of how music education can be, and imagine the future where everybody belongs to the sound world. So that's sort of my own provocation to myself. And just a few words of introduction to see how I'm going to actually navigate my way through, so to speak. I'm in presenting two different ways in which the music education has been constructed. My purpose is not to suggest a polarity or a binary approach to music education research, just to highlight the importance of coming to know about music education by knowing how both music and education can be understood in many ways. So central to my first perspective is the concept of music as an art object presented for aesthetic contemplation. This will be familiar to all of us. And of course, it has its origins in a 19th century notion about creation and reception in music, supported by practices of testing and measuring music capacities, which are rooted in experimental psychology of the early 20th century. And we can see how some of those ideas about music have found their way into the construction of music as a school subject. For example, we can recognize the practice whereby great works of music are listed, which are considered to be essential in everyone's music education from an early age. Exposure to and familiarization with these canon is a mark of a good music education. Music has meaning which can be accessed by coming to know these rules, and the role of the teacher is to support the learning and coming to know music by developing competence as listener, performer, and composer. Models of music education built from this have become enshrined in curriculum documents. They frame the way in which we approach how value is placed on music in the young child's life and by whom. How music is selected for use with the young child and by whom. And how notions of competence are ascribed for the child and by whom. And I want to outline how we as researchers trace the way in which a musical world is presented and protected in the field of music education by looking at how it has evolved as a subject in the school program, as I mentioned. We can see this played out today, taking the national curriculum as an example, where the purpose of a high-quality music education is stated in England as to engage and inspire pupils to develop a love of music and their talent as musicians, and so increase their self-confidence, creativity, and sense of achievement. And for me, it's really important to see that the development of a love of music sits alongside the development of talent as musicians. We must remember that both of those are constructs originating in psychology, and they deserve careful consideration as they raise a number of issues about conceptions of value, selection of music, and competence. Research undertaken into the development of performance skills has been arguably the most visible thread running through music education research historically, and it has certainly become cornerstone on which a tradition of an instructional model of teaching has evolved. While learning to be a competent musician is one way in which a knowledge base for music education can be described, it's not the only way. And my purpose of including a second perspective is to explore this. The concept of music as something people do brings with it a set of rules which move away from a focus on competence and puts the relationships between all those involved the centre. In this second perspective, knowledge is contingent, the consequences of cognitive and social interaction, with its meaning negotiated among the participants. Rules and their implementation are not enough. They depend on the meaning of those rules, particular to the individual situation, and on the experiences of those involved. So this move from learning to be a competent musician to becoming a culturally competent changes the nature of the knowledge base in music and also that of education. So by being human, each of us grows up in a sound world. It's all around us, in our environment, both physical and immediate, imagined and virtual. In this sense, while music education is about becoming familiar with music through encountering it as an object within some paradigm, it's also about recognising that such encounters are not placeless, and education can be concerned with developing a familial relationship with ourselves and our world. It involves knowing ourselves, our world, and our place in it. It is wherever we locate ourselves. So I'm saying this as a beginning just to give you an idea of my thinking and my own journey through music education and some of those elements there about structure and relationship and so on is where I'm coming from. But I thought it was a really good time to do this as well. So I just want to put up, just by way of a flash thought, this is what I'm considering in a sense, what we're confronted with, I suppose, or what we're invited to consider nationally at the moment in terms of an ecosystem or the participants in an ecology of learning. It's taken from the National Plan for Music Education. So we have three parts of knowledge, you know, three potential knowledge bases. We have curriculum music, we have instrumental and vocal lessons on ensembles, and we have musical events and opportunities. So just keeping those in our mind as the sorts of knowledge bases potentially that we're talking about. And then the second flash, and these have all been taken from the National Plan, so they're pretty much as they say in the tin, is what I think we could call the musical world, or a version of the musical world. So you have at the centre children and young people, then you have the school music development plan, then you have the academy trust music development plan, local plans for music education, and then the national plan for music education. So this sort of world in education is what's being presented right now and being implemented or being considered by educators, by musicians, by schools, by policymakers, and so on. So I think it's very pertinent to have this conversation because I'm really looking forward to it. So that's as I said, just as a way of putting this into context. But in terms of what I wanted to talk about first, I just want to address the first part of my lecture, and that is just to look at the way in which music in education evolved as a particular form of knowledge. And we have to go back to Carl Seashore's measurement of musical talent, which is considered to be the earliest test of musical capacity. It was predicated on a theory of specifics, that is, where the ability in music is understood as a genetically determined capacity, evidenced by a set of loosely related basic sensory discrimination skills. There were many others, which you probably know, Arnold Bentley, Herbert Wing, Edmund Gordon, all of those, while each of them differed in some respects, taken together they present a compelling justification for reinforcing a particular view of musicality, namely that it can be graded and standardised. Now, the presentation of musicality as a set of discrete measurable behaviours has influenced decisions concerning the organisation of learning in the classroom, the selection and content of musical knowledge in curriculum, and the manner in which progress is identified and measured. Indeed, the test itself can become the focus of teaching, with its emphasis on product over process, and an expectation that mastery is discernible to teachers and demonstrable in the learner. Most of all, it facilitates the presentation of music as art object, accessible through engagement as listener, composer, or performer. Now, researchers such as Panos Kanellopoulos, writing from a sociological perspective, have called into question the presentation of what he calls the psychological approach to understanding music education practices. And his particular beef with that is that it just doesn't pay attention to the context in which the learning takes place. It's almost like a one-size-fits-all, the idealized child. And so he suggests that it doesn't consider the intentions that children bring to music making, the toolkit of strategies on which they might draw according to their prior experiences, and the requirements of each situation in which they find themselves. And so this brings me to the notion of the sociological approach to children's musical practices, we'll see if they will yield different sets of conceptions about music education. So there has been in the 70s a move away from predominantly psychological versions towards bringing into like different discourses. So changing rules and changing perspectives. One alternative way of looking at the rules of the game was presented by John Blackie, who will be known to you as an ethnomusicologist. But he also came from the Western tradition, was brought up in the system of tests and learning the rules of the game. And when he was outside his comfort zone, he realised that actually the tools I have are no good to me. In fact, they're a barrier to my way of communicating with these people and with their music. His ideas, he felt he was stunted by his education, and particularly he actually mentions the Seashore tests, because they are based on discrimination of some kind, but they're culturally specific to Western classical music, system of intervals and scales, but not universally applicable, and they must not be presented as such, he says. They're clearly relevant only to the cultures whose musical systems are similar to that of the tester. But he calls into question their usefulness. What do the tests actually test? And how far is it related to musical ability? So it's quite controversial, but it had quite a bit of traction among the music education researchers. And another name that I just want to put into this conversation is the sociologist Christopher Small, who actually rejected the notion of music as a stable or a fixed entity, and suggested that it isn't a thing, it's actually an activity, something people do. So a starting point for articulating his theory of music education is to move away from asking questions of the music as object or artifact. So what does this piece of music mean? It held no interest for him. But asking ourselves instead the wider and more interesting question, what does it mean when this performance of this work takes place at this time, in this place, with these participants? So you can see that moving away from the focus of meaning in music as artifact, we can begin to see possibilities for considering how the context in which the music in takes place and the relationships between all those involved in music in become central. And these relationships are to be found not only between those organised sounds, which are conventionally thought of as being the stuff of musical meaning, but also between the people who are taking part, in whatever capacity, in the performance, and the model or stand as metaphor for ideal relationships as the participants of the performance imagine them to be. Relationships between person and person, between individual and society, between humanity and the natural world, and even perhaps between humanity and the supernatural world. So the writings of Small and Lacking, you can see them in traces of coming through research, they had considerable influence on the way in which music education researchers have come to think about musicality in latter years. For example, Thomas Torino sees great values in the phenomenon of music as a human experience and puts great import on the relationships of those involved as participants, with everyone equal, and where the emphasis is more on taking part than on presenting the artwork. You can see the resonances there with Lacking and indeed with Small. But if we as musicians and music educators as researchers accept that music is more than a set of skills which can be tested, we need to avoid reducing the role of music education to that of music training. Instead, we must look for ways in which a conceptualization of music education takes into account not only the content, but the people and the places in which the music education takes place. We must move away from the idea of master-apprentice, where the purpose of music education is to transmit knowledge of music as artwork, focusing on Western art music, towards a model of education where what matters is the transformative nature of the encounter with music for all those engaged in it, and the centrality of the context within which the musical encounter takes place. And this brings me to another thread that comes through in music education research, and that is the idea of critical pedagogy. And you might just be familiar with the work of Paulo Freire. Jenny very helpfully referenced it there, but not rehearsed. But this concept of critical pedagogy asks us to look at what is the purpose of music education. So there's a transformative purpose built into it. So it started with the social context in the Brazilian context. He was a social worker, and he wasn't a musician, and recognized that those who are involved in the teaching and learning encounter have a part to play in their own education. It sounds fairly commonsensical, but actually sometimes we miss it in research. They're encouraged to assess and critique the content, the material, let's say the prescribed curriculum in our case, by becoming aware of the conditions that shape their lives, and from there acting to take ownership of changing them. And this he calls conscientization. Our bell hooks cause critical awareness and engagement. This blurs the distinction between teacher and learner, as both of them work together to address the challenge or the problem identified. So it puts education in a much bigger, a more political frame, I guess. Freire likened education to a banking system, rooted in the notion that information can be consumed, deposited, and stored for retrieval. His point is, students articulate for themselves what they want or need to learn, informed by their view of the world and the problems they pose from the experience they have. And writing from her perspective on engaged pedagogy in a multicultural context, Bell Hooks notes that both teachers and learners are engaged in this transformation. And then more recently, I'm just going to mention one of them because obviously I can't mention all of them. But Juliet Hess asks how music education can contribute to the social climate. And she cites racism, violence targeted at people who embody difference, and so on. Her point is, following Freire and the others, that music learning intrinsically involves exploring social, political, historical, and cultural contexts, and that musical activism can provide a significant mechanism for music learning. And the question she asks are, how might youth interact with music and music education in ways that validate their experiences and help them to develop their own unique voice? How might such interaction with music education contribute to social change? The questions such as these remind us that the lived experience of a learner transcends any boundary between what takes place in school and outside, so their artificial distinctions. In the context of music, they invite us to enter into conversations with each other about the purpose of music education, provoking further questions. And I quite like that last quote there by just adapted from Belwick saying, I thought this was a music lesson. Why are we talking about non-music things like race or class? You know, it cuts very deep in terms of challenging our assumptions. So it's an active learning process entangled with empowerment and liberation. The focus is not on working within structured structures, but in moving away from the tried and tested routines. The focus moves from performance to participation, from measuring individual endeavour towards celebrating belongingness, and it puts the context of learning in the heart of everything. Now, somebody from the field of education, Gert Biester, whose work I really admire, he advances the notion that curriculum is a way of presenting the world to the learner and of representing the world for the learner. And in doing so, he suggests a world-centered education. And this is one where the emphasis moves from the teacher towards the world. The teacher's responsibility is to point the learner to the world. This is not to discharge the teacher from their responsibilities, but it's just to see that the key task of the teacher is to point the student to the world, to redirect the student's attention to the world, so that it becomes possible, without any guarantees, of course, that the student may meet that which the world is asking from him or her. He points to the limitations of words that we use quite often, words such as learning and development, arguing that they are directionless. To the extent to which the word learning has any meaning at all, there is always the need, he says, to specify what the learning is about and what it is supposed to be for. So if we apply this to music education, we could ask ourselves, what is the learning about and what is it supposed to be for? In some cases, our responses might be that the learning is about social mobility. In some cases, it might be it's about learning competence, learning to be a performer, composer, learning repertoire. It might be about learning, developing in our learners self-esteem to take their place in the world we have created for them. In other words, it could be argued that our response would be that the learning is about limiting options, thinking back to rapping, rather than opening them up, particularly where the learning is for development of expertise in a set of skills which prepare some more than others for a world of music making. And this gets to the heart of the teacher's dilemma. It's a common sense argument, which Biester also talks about, and particularly in teaching and teacher education. He notes a move towards competence as the dominant way of talking about learning and talking about teaching, and to the extent that it's become a hegemony and begins to monopolise thinking and talking. And he says that, well, if there's no alternative discourse, if a particular idea is simply seen as common sense, then there is the risk that it stops people, if I'm thinking of teachers particularly, it stops people from thinking at all. So it's this common sense argument that has such a compelling and pervasive discourse in matters of music education that it hardly gets articulated, because there's no need. Everybody knows music is good for you. We don't need to defend it. We all know what we mean by music, this sort of thing. And there is concern that the material being used and tested in schools leans heavily on Western classical music, with its focus on diatonicism, major and minor interlanding is one. The prospect of offering an alternative is not necessarily a culture. We could argue, and I'm being a little bit provocative here, that a system of music education which has originated from a discrete set of behaviours has perpetuated a concept of musicality which privileges one musical tradition over another. And in this light, just going back to the national curriculum, just consider the dilemma for such teachers who are presented with a directive or an expectation such as this. As pupils progress, they should develop a critical engagement with music, allowing them to compose and to listen with discrimination to the best in the musical canon. Now, statements such as this assume a homogeneity of values, of experiences, of preferences, or tastes, and they have, I believe, a colonizing effect on music education. The contents of what's best in the musical canon tends to be catalogued according to an atomistic notion of musical knowledge, created from behaviours predominantly found in Western classical music traditions and paradigms of listenership, composing and performance practice. And if this is presented to all those in education as the musical world available to them, with no reference to alternatives, it provides only a partial account of what is possible and what can be imagined. These behaviours can be standardised in the field of education through curriculum, with norms and expectations for development structured around them, legitimising the culture of testing as a means by which to appraise efforts in music and to shape the content and manner of what should be taught. Now, just to return to Small's ideas of musicking and Blacking's call to rethink the way in which we've allowed Western classical performance practice of presenting musical reception by a listener and audience to be presented as universal. If we take their ideas on board, we can begin to see that the environment where composer, performer, and audience exist independently of each other can be one of many ways of conceptualizing music, but not the only one. We can begin to reimagine the audience as performers, insofar as they can also become involved in the recreation of the work of art. So we can see that our musicality doesn't exist in a vacuum, but is shaped by the environment around us. We can see how musicality as a psychological construct might be recast and reimagined in real-world contexts. For example, the work of Patricia Sheehan Campbell and Catherine Marsh have really taken this on board, using Bronfenbrenner's ecological model as indeed Queen Schippers has done in terms of world music and global perspective of learning. So they all remind us too that discussions about whether music education is conceptualized around music as object or music as activity must not be insulated from the world, but nested within it, taking account of the fact that both the teacher and learner encounter the world through their experience of music education. So I just want to go on to one of the next threads in my talk, which is about new materialism, which I'm really, really finding fascinating. I wish I learned about it years ago, but I'm just really immersed in it at the moment. But these discussions, I think, can be really, really insightful for how do we actually reimagine, for how I can help to answer my own questions, reimagining relationships between music and the world. And so they're leading to new ways of establishing and understanding the role and place of us as humans and our relationship with the world. The human capacity for thinking or reasoning has dominated discussion about the world for far too long, they say. And there needs to be a recognition that there are other non-human, para-human perspectives to take into account when considering how the world can be shaped and developed. As humans, we have grown up in a world based on rational thinking, they say, with an infrastructure based on numbers and codes, which, as Salome Vogelin argues, is always and unavoidably the design of a human thought world. Her interest is reimagining the way in which materials, in particular sound materials, can connect and work together, bringing within it a conception of the world as a relational field. And in this reading, she suggests that sound is not this or that, but the in-between of them. So by looking at the musical world in this way, we can see that nothing is fixed or anchored. There's no definitive version of the thing, but multiple possibilities of engaging with it and imagining it. Everything remains fluid and uncertain, not necessarily as precarity or as a state of anxious fragility, but as a, what she calls, a serendipitous collaboration between the multiplicities of the what is, which I quite like. So placing uncertainty at the heart of music education processes has, of course, implications for the way in which we conceptualize music teaching and learning. It makes appreciable other possibilities about how things might be and how things might relate, and it serves to consider positions and positionings of materials, subjects and objects in a different and more mobile light. It invites us to look at the sound world in new and unimagined ways and to develop a sonic sensibility in ourselves and others. And according to her, a sonic materialism foregrounds personal responsibility and participation, not to deny our being in the world and the world being for us what it is through our being in it, but to embrace the human ability to think of this position as relative rather than as central, to appreciate our responsibility in how the world is, politically, ecologically, socially, and to initiate change and a different attitude. Let's just pause and explore this in relation to the teaching and learning context. Where the teacher as adult has had a longer experience of being in the world, their relationship with the sonic world is framed by looking at music as it is, that is, as sounds organized in accordance to rules and materials arranged in a particular way. Where this is recognizable as something known and familiar to the adult, it can be understood as good music and selected for inclusion in the teaching tunes for the learner, as something to pass on, transmit for them. There is evidence of this in a particular way in the canon described in many curriculum documents. What the new materialist would say is that this view calls to mind a view of music as culturally entrenched within a tonal system, which is so much part of the sound world that we think of it as natural, or the way things are, common sense obviousness. We see this also with sound sources. Instruments are tuned in one particular way, with timbres or tone colours arranged in families, broad categories, you know well. What if we were to reimagine this so that the sound world had a different reference point, where these structured structures of sonic possibilities were no longer acting as structuring structure? I'm borrowing here from Pierre Bourdieu, but I haven't got time to say anything else about that. What might this sonic sensibility offer? Here the young learner has less to unlearn than the adult teacher. What's needed is a culturally responsive approach to the music education, where both teacher and learner engage in co-learning, cooperating on the sounds to form new creations. It necessitates moving away from the closing off of sounds, vibrations, noises, external to the sounds at the centre of the experience. For example, it eradicates the need for concentrated listening to music presented for contemplation. It places the listener within the music and not outside it, listening, attending to it as an object or thing. So it does challenge some of the ideas put forward in curriculum documents to teachers about what is expected of them. Now at this stage, I'm doing okay for time? At this stage, I really do want to spend a little bit of time just sharing with you what I'm calling on the brink of this road to infinity. And it was I had a chat with Jane earlier today, and it was really wonderful because Jane has walked the walk in this one. So working with Alan, at least with Pedro and Aston, were hugely influential in putting together sort of the counter to the hegemony, if you like, that was in existence. But I just thought, reading it again, I mean, this is 50 years on, I must remember that, I just want to read this out loud. Alan, it begins the book. Alan, age 6, moves stealthily around the classroom. He is the wolf, creeping out of the deep, dark forest. As he moves, he makes music, a pattern of mysterious taps and scraping sound, which tells us the wolf and the forest are sinister and fearful. No one has instructed him. Alan chose the drum himself and decided himself how the wolf's music should go. As he creeps slowly across the room, he's lost in the world of his imagination, intensified by the music he's making. This is not my choice. The scene being described here is provided as an example of how education can be alive with the excitement of discovery, with exploring music as part of the wild field of human experience, and with moving away from recreative towards creative activities. From a research perspective, however, there's no evidence that Alan is imagining what the observers claim, and therein lies one of the limitations activities such as this pose for the practitioner. Nonetheless, there is an important point to make about this vignette, and it is this. The opportunity to explore is provided to Alan, where he decides how, what, where to be in the space. A conscious effort has been made to remove any boundaries between school subjects so that what matters is space for exploring. Painter and Aston's curriculum classroom projects in creative music making set out to bring the notion to experiment in music to the fore so that the child learns by doing and by working with the musical materials can come to know them and their possibilities. In this respect, they considered sound and silence to be central. By simply being in the world, Alan has the capacity to explore the musical materials, to act on them, and to develop new ways of knowing himself and his relation to the environment. But looking at it with the wisdom of hindsight, there's much that's omitted from this vignette. We don't know the background to the activity, and as educators we probably would want to, or why the activity takes place in a classroom setting, and not outside in the forest, for example. We've no information about Alan or the instructions or the motivation of the activity. We don't know who else is in the room. We don't need to hear his perspective on the purpose of the activity. We can only imagine what is happening through the eyes of the authors. They observe his movements and they interpret his intentions. Now, leaving aside the fact that this is obviously an idealized version of music making, I don't want to overrate it, and it's also set against the background of its day, we can recognize that the scene being conjured up is an effort to reimagine classroom music as a way of countering the hegemony of music education, which I mentioned earlier, rooted in experimental psychology, with an emphasis on trying to understand how humans process sounds presented to them for concentrated attention. The vignette certainly invites us to consider how we might focus our attention on developing new forms of knowledge rather than recreating or mastering old or tried and tested ones. And in hindsight, I think we must acknowledge that the efforts made by Painter and Aston to create an experimental learning ecology didn't really go far enough in creating a viable alternative to the learning ecology of the classroom of the 70s. There are challenges to overcome, not least in countering the perception that anything goes in education, or that there's no attention to or need for quality of experience. Seen from a contemporary research perspective, what was needed then was a reimagining of the learning, the role of the actors, adults interpreting the actions of the young people, doesn't sit so well, and a move away from the structure on which the teaching and learning was built. What was needed was a learning ecology that, as Peter Woods notes, would reimagine the relationship between teacher and learner, and where the definition of learning shifts towards a means of engaging and building community. So this, of course, is not without risk to move away from tried and trusted ideas about music and education. We must surely have something in its place. It's not an accident that music is object and education is training have persisted. And alternatives to the canon have not had much traction. And we don't have to look too far back to find examples of extending boundaries. Say, for example, Stravinsky and Cage were two that sounded really out there at the time. In fact, they were probably trying to reimagine the parameters of sound. But that whole discourse remains peripheral in music education and in much of what happens in music education. This is my concern. So I think that new materialism offers one such possibility to imagine a new musical world, one which is concerned more with environment, the relational aspect of being in the world, than with scenery or looking at something from the outside in. And I just want to summarise now, because I do want to leave time for questions. But I think that I'll just finish before I summarise by saying that experimental music does offer an opportunity for music educators to consider the full range of musical forms that intentionally break from or never involve themselves with aspects of Western classical music, such as dimensions of pitch relations and synchronized rhythms. It allows us to challenge the foundations of Western classical music. Because there's no history, learning and co-learning become central. Presenting the teacher as expert is no longer appropriate because it is by its nature experimental. There are no certainties. So just at this point, I just want to go back to where I started from, and if you could hear my summary in light of those two points and see how where I've become in the space of this last few moments, suppose an hour. Research has been predicated on a musical world created by adults, the children, in the formal education system. It's a world where the rules are known to the children, known to the adults, with education focused on implementing these rules, with music conceptualized as a sound world using dimensions of pitch relations constructed from Western classical instruments. We can identify a multiplicity of sound worlds which exist independently of adults in research, where children and young people learn with and from each other, moving between roles and responsibilities which were previously inhabited by adults. Empathy and exploration are considered to be valued learning experiences in themselves. And a critical pedagogy of place, for example, means developing empathy alongside exploration, challenging placeless standardised curricula, and promoting the well-being of place. I think that's really full of possibilities for us. There's so much there that more that we could say about that. But it does involve artistic risks, which require us to move away from the certainty of preempting the outcomes of children's endeavours. I'm looking even here at this. And from focusing on getting it right, on effectiveness, on efficiency. It requires us to create and not to recreate learning spaces for learners. For teachers and for learners, music education can thus be about being and becoming fully human within and around sound worlds, and knowing these as places where, following Lisa, we can be at home in the world. There you go, into the future. That's me finished. Thank you very much for listening.
Imagination possibilities in learning and how we forget that sometimes about control of knowledge, about tonality as a human construct, the teacher interpreting the actions of learners. Loads and loads of thoughts came from Mama. This is giving me a bit of time to work out the questions. So thanks very much, Mary. So we'll take some questions. So Jane's got a hand up and then we'll see if there's anything that's come up online. Yeah, Jane.
So thank you very much indeed. It was lovely. I think you like forewarned me that it was lovely to have that reminder of Peter Aston and John Painter, who were incredibly influential members of staff at the University of York when I was there. I certainly worked with Peter. My recollection is that I didn't do one of John's projects, but I knew an awful lot of people who did. I said to Janet Mills and Janet Hoskins, who were just a year ahead of me at York, this new way of looking at music education was incredibly powerful. And it's been a source of, and there was a conference. You might have been at it at Exeter. I think Piers Spencer, who was another colleague of mine then, my accompanist actually, put on a conference actually in memory of John Painter. And we looked again at what had happened. I don't know, maybe 10 years after he died. Sorry, this is all kind of preamble to a question I really do have. I was lecturing on last Friday on the development of musical expertise, and the previous week I had done my kind of history of musical aptitude, the concept of musical aptitude, and aptitude testing, which, as you said, goes back to Seashore 1919 and the psychology of musical talent, and then the tests that he developed in 1960, and I go through the whole history of the tests, and then we look at what actually is musical aptitude. And Susan Hallam and her team did an enormous amount of work on this about 20 years ago, looking at experts' views of musical aptitude. And you know, the tests really don't tell you anything useful about, because they're not reliable, they're not valid, all kinds of reasons. And so I go on and I explain that this is really why Mullins, Finland, his colleagues at Goldsmiths developed a musical sophistication test. And Erica Boren very recently has produced a test called the Musical Child, which is based on one aspect of the musical sophistication test. And I said to the students, this is the one I feel hopeful about, because it recognises what Hallam and her team really showed, that the concept of musicality is a social construct and that it varies from one culture to another and from one time to another. And so one question is, how do you feel about contemporary aptitude tests and tests of musical sophistication, etc., etc.? And secondly, how do you think we could actually make something happen? Because people have been talking about this in music education research since I was an undergraduate student at the University of York in the 70s.
Great questions. I'm going to take the second one because I didn't do that one easily. Not that easily. More easily than the first one. And actually, the idea of tests, I hear, you know, the weight of history shrieking into my ear, saying, "Well, tests will measure what you know, whatever you want them to measure." I imagine my own stuff on psychology of music with Desmond Sargent was really, really interested in it at the time. But as I've come into, I suppose, reflecting on the value of this, and I suppose power relationships and. Yeah, who's to say who's musical? You know, issues of democracy come into play. I'm not a great believer in tests. I love to have conversations about how I'm. You know, I think the being and the becoming. I don't mean it as a woolly, fuzzy thing. I actually really mean that our starting point, before we do it, before we go anywhere, we are human. I've thrown that out in a lot of different contexts, and I've yet to have anybody contradict me. So I'm so far from that. You know, we are human and we're in the world. And being human in the world is what we are. But becoming fully human is where I'm going with education. And so if you think about that, and it is idealized, and it is to infinity and beyond, you know. I'm not going to infinity, which is I think what the tests do, and I think John Painter did. They went to infinity and then they said, wow, and then they came back again. So I wish they had gone to infinity and beyond. Where would we be now if they had done that? I'm thinking here of Elon Musk and going to Mars. You know, they say, okay, it'll take me 3 years. Okay, I can live with 3 years and then I'll come back again. 6 years of my life, yeah, it's worth it. I will go to Mars because I know I'm working from a position of certainty. But I think it's the pioneering, and I'm not sure I see it yet in ourselves. I'm talking about myself as well, in the music education research thought or mindset. Be pioneering enough to say, actually, no, let's just go and see what happens to infinity and beyond. What's the worst thing that can happen? We lose certainty, but we learn. And so that really excites me. It excites me about sound, the possibilities of sounds. It excites me about the tests because they will now be peripheral. And for people, there's nothing wrong with tests. I love tests in one way, but they are not for everybody, and they only. I don't want to be tested about how human I am in the world. It doesn't really fit. But my empathy, my satisfaction, my feeling of being fully human. Yeah, I want to live a full life. I want to be provoked. I want to be prodded out of my smugness. Not that I'm smug. My certainties. Or, you know, I want to be elated all the time by life, sort of thing. And there's no test yet about that. Does that answer one of these partially more
regressive? Do you know, I don't think I've ever heard anybody say John Painter didn't go far enough. And I love it. I think that's so thought-provoking because it was so radical.
Well, it is radical. I'm not taking from that the reader journey, as you know. But it's just how we now look. And it's the wisdom of hindsight, remember. You know, when I saw the John Painter book, I honestly thought I had died and gone to heaven because I couldn't articulate it. But I knew that I could feel the air of another planet, sort of a moment. But now, as I was looking, 50 years on, I'm saying, John, you really should have gone beyond. Somebody would have followed you. And then we'd be looking back and saying, gosh, are they still doing tests?
Do we have anything
Not yet from online. It is lagging behind quite interestingly. Okay. So, but can I ask a question? Oh, there's someone else there. Thank you so much, Mary. So many things I want to talk to you about. Fascinating and so rich. It's really making me think about a lot of things. One thing that I find really interesting is our concept of Western classical music. You referred to it there a few times, right? And this problem that when I think of that through the whole educational journey, even I, with my bi-country experience, can see a lot of difference, right? So that is, and then I have worked with colleagues who come from other European countries, very much, you know, Western classical music, but the training was fundamentally different, the stages of training that they went through. So what interests me is, on the one hand, how do we account for that? How do we sort of get to that granularity in the underbelly there? But also, how and why does it come out the same? Where does this sort of ideological brainwashing essentially end up? Because certainly by the time I met these colleagues, we were playing in orchestra situations where everyone shared that goal of there is the object, there is the work, there is a perfection, you know, that is absolute, that, you know, there is that everyone had arrived at that place. So where and how does that happen, and how did something that to my eyes looked much more like what, you know, where Paynton and Aston might have wanted to push us in the 70s as the initial stages, why did it still end up there?
Yeah, that's a really good question, and that does deserve, you know, a lot of more time. But I will just say that it's about what counts as knowledge, and what's legitimised knowledge. And so if you think about the acoustic property of a sound, which is, you know, we can hear it, and then through the sort of filter of psychology, it becomes, you know, we notice it as sound, we notice it as pitch, you know, a construct or a concept, and then that's mediated into education as high, low, bass, you know, all of that. So you have basically what is a physics going in through psychology and coming into the education. And that's why, you know, it's sanitized, I would say. It's standardized, it becomes normalized. And the diatonism comes directly from the Bentley tests, all of the tests of, you know, measuring intervals and so on, all fitting neatly into the approachable, you know, accessible canon that has been considered desirable in schools. And that's, I mean, that goes back to the beginning of national systems of education. Certainly in my own country, Ireland, I've done a trawl through that. And there is, you know, it doesn't just happen. It is. I think Jenny mentioned that it's controlled. It's, you know, it's a set of values that are imposed, if you like, and that's a little bit political, imposed from the centre and enacted on the ground, and it assumes a homogeneity. It assumes that everybody's going to run with it, regardless of how they have their personal preferences. So what you were saying is that sort of, if you like, a tension between the institutionalized set of practices that are recognized by everybody as such, and the individual interpretation of that, and the tensions that might exist in saying, okay, I don't really want to do this, but I have to because I'm trained to do it. You know, there's a lot of that word, your term, really speaks to me about the structures. There are structures, they're invisible, but they are persistent. And they're structured structures, because that means they're not serendipitous. And then they become the structuring structures. So in 2023, you can still talk about, the so-me is a descending minor third, and it's always going to be sad. And if you said that anywhere, probably in Europe, they'd understand, recognize, they mightn't agree. And in fact, I'd go so far as to say, if you said that anywhere in the English-speaking world, they would nod with it, because then people would recognize it. Doesn't mean that it's good, desirable, but I'm afraid that's where music education is. And this is why I would love if we, or somebody in the next generation, just says, actually, let's just be bold. I'm not saying that it's bad, you know, I'm not saying that what people, that our cultures, our heritages are bad. I'm not interested in good, bad. I'm not making value judgments. I'm just interested in possibilities and in imaginings. And imagining a sound world that does not exist, that's really, just think, I'd love to have that on my epitaph. Does that answer part? That's a big question and it deserves more time.
Absolutely, no. This is something that struck me when we were doing a show. It's something that reminded me, people think I'm mad when I say I don't agree that instrumental lessons should be free. So this is something we've talked about, don't we? Instrumental lessons should be free for everybody. That's what we used to do. And it was like, well, no, not necessarily, because what do? We can't give instrumental lessons to everybody. So how do we decide who has them or not? We have to test them. We test them using aptitude tests. So therefore, we completely go back the circle again. So these things, you know, they've got some quite big connotations. We have to think through these things very carefully when we call for things that used to happen. Because, yes, things can be free, but it's got to be done in a different way. Because we'll just revert back to our aptitude testing, and then the cycle will repeat itself again, won't it?
Actually, that's a really interesting point. I think that's probably where we have been a little bit comfortable. And I say we, as you know, music educators, music education researchers, we think that's okay. Well, actually, that's the default position, and this is what I mean about the common sense argument. You know, why would you want to deprive children of having music lessons? Well, because maybe they don't want to have them. Maybe they want to, you know, maybe they want to be in the in between of that. I find this a fascinating potential for change. Also why I put it at the beginning and the end of my presentation, because I think we have a really good opportunity now. Okay, this is the national plan, setting the agenda, but it has three different parts of it. And if we think of those as three interrelated, closely woven together possibilities for imagining a sound world, instrumental lessons will certainly be there. And we can reimagine what's called curriculum music. We can reimagine what events look like. So I see possibility there, but it's in the hands of people who are willing to go on that journey into infinity.
Thanks. It was really, it's terribly stimulating and actually really inspiring. It sort of reminds you why you're in a place like this, doesn't it? That way that education should be and that music should be, or idea of being participatory in that object. My question sort of linked to me because I find that idea of what we've done in the West with music as a commodity versus other music making around the world, which is much more participatory, really interesting. And I heard Ian Cross give a talk where he talked about this, and he talked about how we've got this acronym WEIRD, haven't we? A lot of research has been on WEIRD, people, white, educated, industrialized, rich, and democratic. And he's, I don't know if he's written it yet, but he's got this theory about how music needs to be peculiar, participatory, evolution, community, and it's really lovely. And he presents this really kind of lovely justification of this idea that what westernised music has become has demolished what the real value of music making is, in that it's a participatory thing that is shared and that helps people to bond and to be together and to form communities. And I just wondered if you thought possibly some of the problems with how we see education in the West, is that too crude to reduce it to perhaps some of the way the Western values have pushed music as an object?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Partly, maybe. I mean, remember that education is funded. And it's, you know, what is the origin of, why is education funded? Because it's preparing citizens to do something. Perhaps in a neoliberal economy, it's preparing them to, you know, make money and bring success to a business. And, you know, that's a very classic way of saying it. But that's what it is. So it's never value free. So, I wouldn't like to sort of generalise according to the West and the non-West, because actually it's not the nations, it's the ideas, isn't it? So I think I'd go with you to say that it's maybe not geographically located. I mean, it's unfortunate that it's Western music that suggests a geographical location, but perhaps we could live with the idea that it's different approaches or different values And they need, you know, you're all in the world. That's where I feel that that might be the way to start that, the answer to that question. And then see how do these, why are these where they are? Why are they located there? So, yeah, I don't know, it's a complicated network of responses that are needed for that, but I think I agree with you.
Yeah, no, that's really nice. Yeah, I agree. Perhaps it's not the geographical areas, is it?
Yeah, because people in the West, like, for example, I'm Irish, I'm not a traditional Irish musician. But, you know, so what, why? Well, because I'm not. But I'm from Ireland. You know, I've been brought up with don't identify yourself in terms of music as geographically located, because it just doesn't make any sense. But I will just say that the term Western classical music is a lazy term, and I used it here. But it is the, you know, it does have currency within the system. And so, but that's also lazy, you know. But there are people, and I do hope there are people, and you know, here in this place, and in our, you know, in the Royal College, and other places, who really get the idea of the power of music. So it can be all of everything that they want. And this idea of music leadership, and what does that actually mean? You know, you've got so much to transform and create new possibilities. And I think that we have a role as educators to really just hold the space. And when they do that, we're not asking to fill a space with stuff. Hold the space where ideas can happen, and new threads, new shoots of possibility in music education emerge. So I would say maybe John Painter was green shoots at a time when they needed them. But you know, they can't do it, couldn't do it on their own, even with Jane's help.
That
idea of vulnerability is really an interesting one. And of course, alongside that, the establishment of trust. Mm. But also recognizing that you are, you know, okay, you are going in there, you've got a job to do, you've got somebody to be accountable to and all that, but you're also developing this sort of, you know, the space between, or I like the in-between of the teaching and the learning, the in-between of the process and the project, however you want to define it. So I'd say, yeah, developing that sense of mutual respect and shared understanding of this space. You're not focused so much on, oh, we've got to get it performed for the, you know, for the community and the Christmas canto, or in the community for the spring holiday or whatever. That there's no, you know, the outcome isn't necessarily going to be tested. I think it's about developing that space of where it's flat in terms of hierarchy, and that's not easy. I think Juliet Hess is interesting because she is working from an North American context, which is slightly different from, obviously very different from here. But the idea that that step back from being the one with all the expertise, actually, and you know, what do they want? What is the purpose of what you're doing for the people in the room? I think there's a lot of literature, and I'm very happy to talk to you about it later on. Don't rattle off names, and might leave some out. But I'm very happy to talk to you about it offline. But it's a great question, and I think it's a great opportunity that you have.
Yes, it's been really mind-blowingly fascinating.
Yeah. and a great school to facilitate it.
Sorry?
A great school or context to facilitate that.
Yeah, we've got 10 different schools that we're working with, which all have such different contexts in terms of where students are at and the kind of the way music is supported in the school or not.
I mean, one of the things about the expertise that you bring to the thinking and the imaginings and the possibilities of sounds would be something that would be wonderful, I think, to have in that fabric of the school, where not everybody has that. They have other things, they have other attributes, but it's wonderful that you're actually in that zone. So that sounds like a really interesting project. My one thing, and I'm getting increasingly I suppose a little bit intolerant with myself. Whenever I say music, I want to say to myself, okay, so what do I mean by music? Why am I using that word? I haven't yet got to the stage where anybody says music, I say, okay, what do you mean by music? Because there's an assumption, which is a particular type of music. So I think maybe that's one thing that we could do, just as a small next step, is just for ourselves as educators. When somebody says that they're doing music, they go, okay, tell me about the music. Because from sound to music, there's it's a massive leap.
Great, thank you. We've got time, and then we've got one online.
Yeah. She has to go, I think.
Oh, she has to go.
Is that okay? Yeah, sure.
Can I queue up? Bethan Havron-James, she said, I was wondering with Mary whether you've come across, I'm going to say the name completely wrong, Niam Inayatala, and the work is pedagogy as encounter beyond the teaching imperative.
No, no, I haven't, and I'm going to look it up. So that's great to pick it up. So it's Niam.
The book seems to be called Pedagogy as Encounter Beyond the Teaching Imperative. Then she's writing, competitions seem to play a big part for many conservatoire performing students. Would you broadly classify music competitions as a music test? One. And the pressure of preparing and taking part in competition, the focus on a relatively limited repertoire also seem to be at odds with the broader aim of music education. How do you see the role of competition in music education?
I see it as something that is obviously playing a part, because it's part of the fabric of most institutions, isn't it? I have a funny feeling that she already knows the answer to that question herself. So competitions are fantastic, aren't they? They're preparing you for the profession. They're a celebration of your activity. So there's only going to be one winner, if there are winners involved.
Someone posted these things about competition with the initials BH. So Bethan is just posting, sorry, those three comments are not mine.
My decision not to do competitions, there's room for everybody and everything. That's a naff answer, but I don't know what other answer to give you.
It's the same as everything, isn't it, Mary? It's not what you do, it's how you do it, isn't it? So
yeah.
When I see the way competitions are worked in our junior department here, it's beautiful. It's all about opportunities, practicing performance, non-competitive competition. It's an opportunity. But then, you look at other competitive music making, and those two things don't go together to make competitive music making.
So then you ask, what's the purpose of it?
And then there's just the education.
Yeah. What's the purpose of it?
If you know what that is, well, then always your choice. Definitely. Talent.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Mary. That was really interesting, and certain framings really were wonderful, like the sound, the smartness of that. Saying I feel like the kind of underlying thesis is to resist the urge to treat students as like widgets, as just sort of, as kind of, my sense is that as long as you can do that in every situation, then you kind of win in every situation. But having said that, I don't know whether you agree, but I always tend to think that you need like a thesis and antithesis sort of situation where was open, purely through that experience, and actually maybe I could have done more of a formal
yeah.
structure where I relied and could tick off things to the list and know what I was getting. And in a way, I feel like I might never close that gap. No,
mm-hmm.
I feel like it might be too late, and that even if I could go back and study first grade theory books or whatever,
mm-hmm.
I still never quite feel like I've internalized it the way I should. So I wonder what you think about that, because I feel like the formal structure is there
yeah.
for a reason, and it's good to have something else that's rich of its own that can push
yeah.
against it, and then through the tooth and get the best result.
That's a great question.
Yeah.
Because it's about people, adults in powerful positions deciding you're not going, you would have loved to have had to know the dots, for example, when you were a youngster, and somebody decided that you didn't, there's all that you were a child and you didn't know what you didn't know and how useful it might be to you. So I suppose it's about the, see, that's where the power of the teacher comes into play as well. I mean, I've done research on that. Actually, my own PhD was on that whole idea about how do people construct the musical worlds in those environments, whether it was in school or whatever. And a lot of some of my participants were coming from non-formal, I hate that word, but that idea that didn't come up through the classical route, so to speak. But they managed to find ways to create something really rich. But they imposed a particular view on people, and they said, okay, one of them had a terrible experience with notation and wasn't going to impose it on the humans in this class. But somebody like you might have been in that class and said, well, I wanted it. So that's the problem with, centralized systems of education, that it does assume a homogeneity of values. Or you can't really, because of the mass education aspect, it's very difficult to offer a bespoke, personalised experience for everybody. It's just physically impossible. So in that system, as you think you're alluding to, there are winners and losers. I would like to have, I suppose for me, it's a long-term thing. This is not a quick fix. This is about unlearning and about everybody taking responsibility for knowing what they know and reassessing why they're doing what they're doing. And in your case, you're learning now as an adult, but you're learning because the purpose of it is here to you. You decided, because you need it. And I wish that could happen in the environments, in schools, where the teacher stepped out of the role of the all-knowing sage and said, okay, well, who's in my room? How can we work here with everybody? Because a one-size-fits-all does not fit everybody. And it builds in, exclusion, it builds in lack of access, it causes labels about approaches to learning and so on. So the real challenge in education is actually to meet the needs of everybody on their own terms. But we're a long way off from that, in a real sense. So you've articulated something that really is, gets to the nub of that, and I'm with you, but it's not going to happen overnight. But there are other people, to put the antithesis to it, there are other people who have been turned completely against music because they did have the classical music training and they never had the chance to say, wow, I love, I'm a singer, I want to be a rock musician, because they only had, there was only one show in town and that was not, didn't suit them. So I don't know if that answers the question, but I really hear what you're saying, and I'm fully in sympathy and in empathy with it, so to speak. But systems, systems are have a lot to answer for.
Okay. So we'll have our last question.
One thought, that keeps going through my mind while we're looking at that, and the next slide on that as well, is, the huge journey of empowerment of teachers that we need to go on, right? Because I'm sort of thinking of the primary school education sector, and where you frequently have the primary school where every single teacher would say to you, but I can't teach music, I'm not, I don't know. So to flip that thinking over, say, if you've got all the expertise you need because you make sounds and live in sounds, and you know. But that's such an interesting journey to take it along, but a huge one. But I wanted to sort of on the back of that come back to the patent example, because when you put it up, what I found really interesting was that sentence in the middle. Nobody instructed him, but he picks up a drum. And I thought, hold on, someone is instructing him because someone put a drum in the room, right? So he is picking up, there are parameters that are set. And it sort of made me think about that, this fact that parameters are always set, that there's always something there. And that brings me to the question of, well, which parameters do we need? And I want to come to your, you know, idea of this infinity and beyond, imagine it. How does that work together with the idea of collaboration? You know, where do you take, what was his name, boy's name, Alan, mm-hmm. Alan as the wolf, and then someone else comes and wants to be the other wolf, mm-hmm. and imagines the whole thing entirely differently, and as he said, we don't actually know what he's imagining at all, right? So at what point and how do we bring some kind of rules or parameters or something in that allows the communication or collaboration?
I mean, that's a really great question. Remember that this is an idealized version, and I'm just going to be equally idealized. And this is, in the next sort of, in the imagined world of music education, let's call it that, I would want to ask the question of John, over here, why did you put Alan in that? Did Alan want to be in that room? Maybe Alan has actually got issues of being on his own, being watched by adults. Being asked to crawl along the floor, it might be cold, it might hurt his knees. And why are you looking at him like that? And that's why, you know, who else is in the room? And what's the purpose of it? Why is a young child of six asked to go around like a wolf? You may never have seen a wolf. You know, just imagine that you were that child in the room. And I am over egging it. But you know, you've asked the question, and that's how it is. So imagine that Alan is, perhaps he's hard of hearing. Perhaps he's uncomfortable with spatial awareness. He's been asked for some reason, we don't know why, to be in the room, pretending a wolf. He doesn't know what a wolf is. And he has to spend, we don't know how long. And then people are saying, he's twitching. He's finding the wolf. You know, whole adult constructs of a forest and the whole idea of fear. You know, they're all adult constructs and interpretations of this child's experience. So my question would be, in terms of developing a pedagogy that's collaborative, who's in the room? You know, let's see how we can be and become, you know, in connection with the forest or the drum. Let's see how we can actually interact with that. And if that conjures up the idea of the fearful forest, then that's fantastic, because that comes from the participants. But it's not the teacher saying, okay, we've got 10 minutes and we're going to have a forest scene in 10 minutes, get going. Okay, watch yourself and mind the furniture. You know, that's the instructor of this mode. And we're built in that mode because we have to account for ourselves. And we have Mrs. or Mr. Black coming along and saying, what on earth are they doing in that room? They're all running around the place like, you know, and that person has no control, etc. You know, there's all that sort of social parameters to consider as well. So, but we're a long way off that. It is beyond infinity. But I just think, yeah, it's okay to imagine it every now and again. But I do know from the practical, you know, the practical side, there's so much tension and so much there that's fraught. But it's not going to stop me asking myself those questions. I suppose that's what I meant. Does that answer that one?
Thank you. I love the way you've brought us to the absolute essence of ethics in education and ethics in music education research, actually. It's a great place to sort of stop and think, isn't it? I think. So I think that is our time up anyway. If anybody's got any real burning questions, I'm sure Mary will have a chat with you. Straight after, but that's been brilliant, Mary. Thanks so much, and let's sit.